Gather, veterans. It's time to join the fight. The long war begins.
This is The Long War. I'm Robbie B, and joining me are my partners in crime, Kenny Boucher and Mike Haspel. Plus, we have a special guest tonight, and we'll get to that shortly. What's up, guys?
Yo, dog. Great to be here.
Yeah, it's pretty good to be here.
So pretty good. Pretty good to be here?
Pretty good. Dude, I had to get up at 4.
Question mark?
I'm like, you know, I need to invoke my totem spirit animal just to stay awake right now.
Got it. So when you say pretty good, you mean the literal exact opposite of that.
I'm like, yeah.
Oh, it's like Salmon Grundy.
Totem spirit fox. Yeah, I'm with you guys now. I'm back.
You're back.
Yeah.
Salmon Grundy was my main character in the Heroes Among Us, the DC versus Mortal Kombat game that came out like 2 or 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It quickly became known online as Rage Quitters Among Us. So OPM balanced.
Born on a Monday, that's Solomon Grundy?
Yes, he has a sick, like, because he's a grappler, and I always play command grab grapplers in fighting games. And he had this chain of grapples you can do if you combo them right, where he says the whole thing, depending on how you do it, if you can link it all, where he's like, Solomon Grundy, born on a Monday, died on a Tuesday. Like, it literally just goes, and depending on how you do it, depends on, like, what buff you get afterwards. I will catch people in this and just, like, literally be slamming them for, like, 8 seconds, and they're just, like, rage quit off Xbox Live.
I remember watching you play some of that. It was crazy.
Oh yeah, you remember? Yeah. I was like, oh, that was the first one they had made before Rage Quitters Among Us. They had made it. I can't remember what it was called. They had made two. Like NetherRealms had made two games. One of them was kind of flopped. Then the Heroes Among Us came out. The first one was so imbalanced. Oh my god! I remember saying, I'm gonna perfect this guy. And he's in a rage quit watch. And Rob was like, oh, my God. Oh, God. It was so fun.
You're like, yo, you want to try? I was like, no. What? No. It's not a first-person shooter.
Was that during when you came up to Colorado to visit for like 2 weeks?
It might have been. Was that game popular then?
Yeah, I think that's about the right timeline.
I know I played a lot of Halo when I was out there.
Yeah, I think you played Call of Duty, too.
Oh, yeah, Call of Duty.
You went and bought an Xbox to set up in your hotel room for 2 weeks so we could play Call of Duty and shit.
One of them first-person shooters. They're all
and then you were
the
trying
same.
To download all the updates on the hotel Wi-Fi, and you're like, well, shit, this isn't going to happen.
Yeah, I don't know what I really expected from, like, a mountain lodge, a log cabin mountain lodge on the side of a, literally at, like, what, 6,000 feet? Like,
8,800 feet in the Rocky Mountains.
I was like, why am I disappointed by this? Of course you don't have it. This is on me.
word. So before we start, I also wanted to say I did an interview yesterday on the Life After podcast or Life After Cover Save podcast.
Oh, cool.
So there's going to be a little cross-promoting there. So, guys, definitely check out the Life After Cover Save podcast. These guys are local to me.
That's
now.
A tight name.
It is good. These guys are great. Ed and Blake, they're crushing it. I think they do 4 episodes a month. They're good guys, and so definitely check them out when you get a chance.
So tonight we have a great show for you. Apparently there's a new codex coming out called Death Watch. All the kids are super excited about it. So we're definitely going to talk about that. We've got the new FAQ segments out, because I guess we're just down to one more FAQ than Necrons, I think.
And demons.
I think Demons came out already. Oh. Or was it Corn Demonkin? I don't know. We might be down to one or two. We're getting down to the end. Tabletop Market Watch, definitely a lot of new products coming out from post-Gen Con. Stuff's basically starting to come out, starting to hit the market. I'm sure Haspel has a bunch of stuff I didn't even know about. You always got that. Got that underground flavor. So I feel like there's a lot, because we were talking. This is actually getting recorded the day after that we normally do the webcast, and then we do the podcast following after it. But we did an interview today, and we'll get to that shortly too. That'll be part of the segment. So We're a little out of sync as far as like what we talked about last night to tonight, because I'm sure there's already been like some new developments. I know Kenny was in his Beats laboratory probably looking at a lot of the Death Watch. Like I came up with some more stuff personally. I was like more combo rules and such. It's like really interesting. It's this Death Watch book, because it's almost like it's like the Oprah of like special rules. So there's going to be a lot to touch on, I think. So I'm pretty sure we have a really robust show for everybody tonight. So let's jump right into Tabletop Market Watch. I feel like, Haspel, what do you got first?
Yesterday, a kind of controversial game came out called Eisenhorn Xenos, which is based on the Dan Abnett book of the same title. It is the kind of game, like, it's one of those, I think it's a fun button masher, but it is those kind of games like Arkham City or Arkham Asylum or Mad Max or Shadow Over Mordor, where you're doing the timed-based combat where you have to wait for a guy to do something and then you hit a certain combination to do it and they send all these guys at you. And Eisenhorn pulls it off, but at the same time it's a little bit clunky because this game is originally made for a mobile platform and they put it out on PC. So a lot of people are disappointed by it because if you were playing this on your iPad, I think people would be a lot more excited, but they were expecting like PC level graphics. And this, you know, if this game had come out maybe 5-6 years ago, it would be the talk of the town. But because it's, you know, it's 2016 now and this thing was made so it can run on an iPad, on the PC it is a little lackluster. I really enjoy it because it allows me to play through a Dan Abnett novel, and Mark Strong does the voice for Eisenhorn, so the voice acting for Mark Strong is unbelievable, and it lets you walk around the Warhammer 40K universe that we don't normally get exposed to in games. You know, when we're playing Dawn of War or even Eternal Crusade or something, all the buildings are kind of wrecked and ruined already. They're just destroyed. You don't see the splendor of the Imperium. And playing as Eisenhorn, you're just like, wow, some of these spaces are just absolutely gigantic. And it's just overwrought gothic stuff. So that's a lot of fun, you know, but the game is super cheap right now. It's like $14. So, and I think for $14, if you enjoy the Warhammer RPGs at all, like Dark Heresy or Rogue Trader, it's a must-buy. If you're just looking for like a really good action combat video game, this is not it. You know, this isn't Space Marine. It's not on that level and everything. But if you like Dan Abnett's novel, it's pretty faithful adaptation of his novel. I, for one, am waiting for the next two to come out because Xenos was my least favorite of the trilogy. So
was there like Ravenor, and what was the other one?
Oh, Ravenor comes afterwards. The original Eisenhorn ones were Xenos, Hereticus, and Diabolus. I think
okay.
Demon right. Hunter. It basically corresponded to the sectors of the Inquisition. The three ordos, the three big ordos. And then Ravenor was his protege that he supposedly trained, who winds up coming after him and everything. And kind of funny story, I was talking to Dan Abnett about that, and I was like, you know, Ravenor's team is a lot like the X-Men. And he kind of just laughed when I said that and was like, yeah, yeah.
Didn't he have to write for the X-Men?
Yes, he did.
Interesting.
So, because Ravenor, for those who don't know, is he's injured and he's like stuck to a chair, like Professor X. So,
got you good.
Just really, really quick, is there is a thing called Warhammer Fashion, and this caught my eye because you know how much I've been talking about. I want T-shirts made after every chapter. I want all kinds of craziness. Mm-hmm. They are coming out with some interesting stuff. So this company called Muster Brand, which does a bunch of other franchises. I mean, they've done Mass Effect, like Assassin's Creed, Diablo, Star Wars, World of Warcraft, Deus Ex, all kinds of stuff. They're actually putting out some Warhammer 40K inspired fashions. They got two things right now. One's like kind of a hoodie sweater that they call Necron, which it's kind of got neon green lining and stuff like that. But the one that's on there, it's expensive. You know it's going to be expensive. but it's so cool. And if I wasn't fat, I would definitely get this, but I can't pull it off. It's called the Commissar Greatcoat, and it is awesome. It looks like a Commissar Greatcoat.
But is it like a shirt or is it a coat for real?
No, it's like a coat for real. It's expensive though. It's like $300.
What? But
yeah, it's pricey. You know, it's gonna it's preferred enemy wallet, man. You know, it's gonna hurt you.
Wallet.
But if you can pull off this coat, it's baller as hell.
It's like every time I see like a Doctor Who coat, I'm like, I'm gonna buy that. A, I don't have $400. B, too fat.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like if I bought the Doctor Who coat, I would look like Silent Bob. I would just be like, oh, I don't look like the Doctor. I look like Silent Bob. Great.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, those are definitely some good finds there. I had kept an eye out on that clothing brand, but I didn't realize it was actually released yet. So that's pretty cool to see, like, you know, T-shirts and all that stuff, pretty cool. There's also a Warhammer art website that I don't think we've talked about that kind of went under a lot of people's radar too, where you can get like the prints and such of, you know, Codex covers or like iconic pieces of art. You know, Marnie is sitting on the throne and stuff like that, and all super framed up, you know, shipped to your door, of course, you know, all done upright. You're talking $200-$300, but if, you know, it's for that person that really wants
it. Let me put it this way. No poster in a poster frame should ever cost $300.
Well, if it's not a poster, if it's like a Geekly printed, you know, print, it could be really awesome, because those, if they use those special printers, it looks like...
Oh, they use like the canvas, like...
Yeah, it looks like a material.
Yeah, if they look like that, then okay, we're talking a different thing here.
Yeah, but I'm with you on the poster.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you can get the poster versions. I'm sure the higher...
Like, I've been to Kinko's. I know how much, like, high-quality photo paper, you know, posters cost on the most expensive scale to produce them, you know? Like,
but they got to license it, dog. They got to license it.
They got to get paid.
You got to get paid.
Gots to get my money.
$350 for that poster. No, I think they look tight, so check it out. There's a Warhammer art website as well. I'm sure it would pop right up in the Googles. Google will never steal your clicks, I assure you. also, this week, if you happen to go to Gen Con, it was a blast. It looked, just judging by all the pictures everybody was posting up, another great year. Kind of getting spread out. I heard from a lot of people that it was kind of hard to find a few things, but... I've never been, so I don't know if that was...
Well, that's been a problem for several years. Like, since even before they moved to Indiana, when they were still in Milwaukee, you would have one event, you'd be playing a D&D game in one venue, and then your BattleTech game that starts in 15 minutes is, you know, three hotels over in a basement or something. It's impossible to find.
That's always...
That happens when it just gets that big.
Oh, we should talk about real quick, Boots to the Ground. We had some people out there. And so this kind of goes into some predictions we've been trying to make about GW, who said that GW had somewhat of a disappointing showing.
Yeah, I heard that from a lot of folks.
At Gen Con this year versus previous years. So I think that is absolutely goes into our predictions about where the company's trying to go with the new CEO's approach to marketing out here. Social media, where they actually want to put their boots on the ground instead of just like blanket, you know, let's just do this, this, and this. How about we look at the numbers, look at the books, see what's been effective in the past. Let's not like abandon things, but let's redistribute our promotion budget for going to these, you know, other conventions in other countries, and let's start putting different money in different places. And that, like when they said they're going to Dragon Con, and now we know they're going to LVO, that kind of proves that they're moving some of these funds around. They're probably using their same exact advertising budget for promoting in another country, but spending it differently to hit, you know, different tournaments.
Get more length out of it too. And we saw this year too, they're at the Las Vegas trade show for the first time. They had previously done an IP show. They had previously done a licensing show out in England. This is the first time they did one in America here. So that's really cool to see that they are, you know, refocusing and maybe looking to put their eggs in one or smaller niche baskets instead of one big ginormous event. Yeah.
And I bet you Gen Con, everyone's like, that was just messed up. Like, I was like, I bet you, they got a spreadsheet somewhere that tracks, like, order numbers and stuff like that has proven to them that being a Gen Con doesn't matter that much. like in their business model. I bet you, I mean, it's like they don't just say, let's just not go to the biggest convention. Like they're just saying it's just not big for us. So they're going to try to go to Dragon Con, which is also kind of not their thing. But Dragon Con's in Atlanta. Like there's obviously a different thing there. And even though it's not as big as Gen Con, it's still gigantic and it's in Atlanta. And then they're going to go to LVO, the biggest, currently, and by my math, the second biggest 40K related convention in the world. Going into 2017, and by my math, also the single largest 40K singles tournament in the history of ever. So I wouldn't be surprised if after 2017 round of conventions, like GW's foothold in the United States is reestablished, and they even start approaching individuals to be spokespeople.
Oh, that would be pretty cool.
That's my prediction for 2017, what GW's doing.
Fun fact, though, is I got back into 40K. I say back into 40K because I had been playing stuff since the 80s, but didn't know it was 40K, like Space Hulk, stuff like that. And at one of the Gen Cons, this is, late 90s, I want to say, 97, 98, around that time frame. Third edition was still out. I happened to walk into an RTT at Gen Con where people were playing, they just happened to be playing Blood Angels against Tyranids. And I looked down and recognized the miniatures from Space Hulk, and I was like, what Space Hulk variant is this? And it was just kind of like this GW red shirt was like, come here, my child.
You know? come hither, my son.
You got it all wrong. I do remember working at a game store. People would come in and be like, oh, so this is like Dawn of War on the tabletop. And I'm like,
Dawn of War is like a video game of a tabletop, sir.
Yeah, I think you got it. Yes, you're not wrong. But let's get you come over here.
Let's get you set up, homie.
Yeah,
it's like walking out of like Civil War or Suicide Squad to keep things relevant, and having somebody go, wow, they made a comic book out of this movie.
Yes, exactly.
It's like when people watch Game of Thrones and like, who keeps writing these books that spoil my Game of Thrones?
Yeah, it's like, oh.
Well, speaking about spoilers, the FFG booth was alive with some spoilers at Gen Con.
Oh, yeah, preach.
All sorts of stuff. And I'm just going to hit on the X-Wing and the Armada. They put out spoilers for a new wave of both X-Wing and Armada. And then this week, the Armada releases came out for Wave 3 and 4. They just lumped them together and like, here you go, guys. So like, oh, well, catch, thanks. Just kind of out of nowhere. So we got for Armada hitting stores this weekend will be the two flotillas, the GR-75 Rebel Transport, as well as the Imperial Assault Gozani, I think it's called. Anyways, so those are coming out. And then, of course, you've got the bigger ships, the Interdictor and the Liberty class.
Did which you say is, the Interdictor?
Yes, that's exactly what I said.
Just want to double check with that one. Got it.
Kenny's a 10-year-old boy.
Yep, he can't turn it off. It's okay. So those are good releases, and of course, Wave 9. If you can buy all these, if you happen to be there, Wave 9 for X-Wing as well is out and about. And nobody really knows when that's going to hit the shelves, but it wouldn't surprise me if it came out soon. And also, you remember last year, Haspel on September 4th was the first day they could start selling merchandise for Episode 7. They Target had that special thing where you could get the new starter, the Episode 7 starter for X-Wing. And so there may be something else at Target's if they decide to do something for Rogue One this year.
Oh, yeah.
Spoiler alert, maybe, question mark.
Well, so far, Rogue One looks like it's all just original trilogy canon, except for some of the Stormtroopers. But there might be some new vehicles. I don't know. Coincidentally, the new trailer is supposed to air tonight on the Olympics, so...
Ooh, it had escaped me as well, so that would be cool to see. I hope Vader's in it. It supposedly makes an appearance, so that'll be fresh. And then on to the Death Watch. So coming out this week, if not already out by the time you hear this, is the Death Mask box set, which we'll do a quick rundown on it here. We've got the it retails for $150, but you get over $400 of merchandise if you haven't heard already. You get the Watch Captain Artemis, 5 Death Watch veterans, 5 Vanguard veterans with the Death Watch upgrade sprue to make them, of course, Death Watch flavored, a Venerable Dreadnought, and then on the Eldar side, you get Eldrad, the brand new, straight out of the 90s, resculpted in a plastic figure, 12 Harlequin players, which are basically two box sets, a Death Jester, a Void Reaver, a box of two Skyweavers, and a transfer sheet, plus a Deathwatch flavored 40K rulebook, or as Games Workshop likes to call it, Warhammer 40,000, comma, the rules.
Yep. Little mini rulebook.
So great deal there. The Codex is also out this week, as well as the data cards, which are the Maelstrom missions, plus you get the mission tactics cards. So, like, you know, you can switch them up in game, so you can slap those down on the table. We all know.
I feel like those will probably be handy.
Yep, all about some game aids there. And the Deathwatch dice set, which a little birdie told me rolls a very, very averagely well. So while the symbols are on the one, they are balanced good, supposedly. Or more better.
And they still put the symbols on the one.
It's just so dumb. Why would you put the symbols on the number you don't want to see? AK, so even if like you designed the dice to never roll ones, you still don't get to see the symbols.
Right.
Like, it doesn't matter how you design it. It's awful. It's poorly designed.
If you're playing the drinking game at home, we need to add that to it. Or
that is on the list. Symbols on ones is stupid. Worth at least two shots.
And we're off to the races. Let's talk about Dreadnoughts. Oh, speaking of Dreadnoughts, the Dreadnoughts in there have four attacks. Yay!
Hooray!
Also, speaking of Dreadnoughts, is there a spoiler alert? A Dreadnought battle coming out of the Beats Lab soon?
Yes, I think. I don't know where we're at with the release schedule.
I think we're finally doing. Have you filmed it yet?
Tropical Dreadnoughts? We have not. I think it's on the books.
It's so basically we're finally doing it in the Beats Lab. We're finally going to do all Dreadnoughts with the how they should be.
Oh, very nice. Yeah. So you're doing the toughness instead of armor. Nice. Well, very cool.
Yeah, that'll definitely be fresh to see. We got to make sure we have some armor crates in it too. Maybe have to find some.
Stupid
armor. Like, which one do you want, armor crate or dreadnought? Choose now. Operators are staying.
Like, let me just put it this way. Like, if the armored crate was armor, let's say, like, what's toughness 6 is like armor 11. So say armor excess 6 wounds, 3 up save. Let's say an armor crate was armor 11, 6 hole points. No save vehicle. Like, you know how fast someone's gonna blow that up?
Oh yeah.
Like, and here's the first last cannon shot of the game, and I rolled a 6.
Yeah. Goodbye. GG.
I mean, that's the only thing the Carnifex has going for it. It doesn't get one shot by a last cannon.
Yeah.
That's about all it has going. Anyways, so let's take a quick break real quick.
Dear veterans, quickly, make your way to thelongwar.net and find out how to reap your hard-earned spoils of this long war. For our allies at Dicehead.com have rewarded us all with an extra 6% discount on all Dicehead.com merchandise. So stock up, dear veterans, and enjoy.
And we're back.
All right, Hobby Maniacs, we've got a special, very special guest for us this week on The Long War. We're here with Em. You might recognize her from Warhammer TV. Now she's a Twitch streamer, and she's known as Electric Eve. She's part of the stream team. And Em, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, so it's Brush Lickers United, and we are a team of various painters. We all paint different things in different styles, airbrush, brush. There's even some sketch artists on there as well, so that's pretty cool. And we all stream our painting and stuff, so
yeah. Yeah, that sounds really cool. I have a couple questions for you. So how long have you been painting?
I've been painting just under 3 years, probably.
It's a lie. It's a lie.
I did get into the hobby when I was about 11, but I was, you know, 11 and into the hobby, so I'm not counting that as my paint. I didn't care about painting. I just wanted to throw a model on the table and beat some people up with it.
Did you were you ever one of those people who used like enamel paints when you first started, like the people who paint, like, you know, airplanes and shit?
No, I was not.
I feel like you had YouTube. You had like tutorials to look up, cause like.
Oh, she's a total millennial, I bet. I have no idea how old she is, but I'm assuming she's 20 years old.
I'm 24.
Yep.
No, I got I took a big break from the hobby to be a teenage girl, and then I got back into it a couple of years ago when I got a part-time job at Games Workshop in the shop.
Oh, very cool.
It was a quite quiet shop, so I then was taught how to paint properly with layers and shades and things I'd never thought about before. So, and well, then I was took on all the store projects, so I painted every day.
that cracks me up because because us oldies, we didn't have, you know, anybody, no resource. And so I remember going to my hobby shop the first time after, like, first off, being super proud of, like, this model I had painted, because obviously I've always been an artist. So I was like, I'm going to blow this up. My shit's going to be so much tighter than other people's shit. Go to the hobby store with this little Space Marine Captain, that original one, and the Terminator armor, and I'm like, I'm going to pull this out and blow people's minds. Get to the store. Everyone's better painted than me. And then I sit down and watch this guy dry brushing, which at the time I thought that was fake painting. I was like, what is he doing? He's just not even really painting. Then I saw, like, the chainmail on this, like, this robe that he was dry brushing. I was like, literally every model I've ever painted in the trash.
Just throw it out.
This is stupid. How come I didn't know about this fake painting? What is it called? And he's like, it's called dry brushing, and it's so easy. It's like, I literally hate it.
Yep.
So what you probably don't know about me is that I actually did make that mistake, because I started painting Warhams in the late 80s, and I used those tester's paints that I'd used on my airplane models. And I did the same thing. I took it up to the game store, I guess around the early 90s, and everybody was a lot better than me, and it made me sad. I think I might have even had a good cry over it.
I did exactly the same thing as you, Kenny. I brought in this Fate Weaver that I brought in, and I thought it was amazing, and I was, again, always fairly good at art, and it was rubbish. It was so bad. And at the time, I was so proud that I couldn't understand why I didn't place. And I was so cross, I didn't go back for a while. And then I realized, no, this is really rubbish. I need to up my game.
It just goes to show, like, how much, and that's kind of one of the things I talk about in my YouTube videos, is technique. Like, there's so much more technique involved in this, in the process, than people give it credit for. It's not, like, you can be the most talented artist on earth. If you don't open your heart and your eyes to the techniques that exist, you're not going to produce good artwork on these models.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I won't say when I started painting miniatures, but it involved Dungeons and Dragons, and was the first number in that decade was still a 7.
Yeah, it's like you just made yourself, dog.
All right. Well, here's another question for you. About how long does it take you, on average, to paint a figure from, like, prime to, like, you know, ready for display?
For a normal kind of model, because on my stream I don't paint to proper display standard, because most of the time, I'm going to be honest, I can't be bothered. like my Alariel that I painted recently, it took me about 16 hours to complete her. I really tried on her. So I guess for just the Alariel lady bit, so about 16 hours for that. But for a normal guy, maybe a couple of hours.
Yeah, because that Alariel is gigantic.
That's the beetle lady, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, she's one big lady.
And, it's definitely the size of a Primarch.
It's huge. It's even bigger. I've painted multiple Primarchs. She's bigger. I have one right here. She's twice the size of a standard Primarch. She is so much more master, like, in area. Because I did watch M go through, like, we were doing on the Blue stream team, the Brushlickers United, they're doing a 30-minute paint challenge. People are posting, they're like, oh, I did this in 30 minutes. She did, like, 4 models, like, back-to-back-to-back, like, in 30 minutes each. That all look better than 99.9% of, like, armies that you see, like, at tournaments and stuff like that. Like, yeah. I was like, if someone just painted spent only 30 minutes on a Space Marine, like, the whole, like, month, like, they would produce a Death Guard army, because she did a Death Guard model that looked better than, like, it would be the 99th percentile of armies you see at, like, 100-man GT.
Yeah. I did the Tree Man. I was quite proud of that one.
In 30 minutes! With a paintbrush, no airbrush.
That is outstanding. That's more the time I have, you know.
They called me a witch.
I think that's the female equivalent of a wizard, so that's probably a compliment.
Yeah, it sounds worse, but I'm going to take it as a compliment. I'm going to take it as a compliment.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, to be able to produce that kind of quality in that short a time, it is, to some people, it is supernatural, you know. It's just, I'm like, there's tricks to do it, but you know, without using tricks, you know, without using like dip and colored primers and all the nonsense I use to go really, really fast.
She was out of control. Like, I couldn't believe I watched it. I was like, I'm not even going to participate in the 30-minute mile challenge. I'm already embarrassed.
But it's all about technique, right?
Yes, yeah.
It is all about technique, but like, even people say, massive misconception with the airbrush. Like, there's a lot of setup time to an airbrush. Like, you know, if you pull out an airbrush to paint one model, might actually take you longer than to just use your paintbrush.
Yeah, with one model, sure.
Like, and that's the whole, like, so the tutorials aren't about, like, speed. Like, when I do my Twitch stream, it's like, I'm showing people how to use an airbrush. So, like, I'm literally taking twice as long on these models because I'm setting up for one model, changing out the color, keep going, versus if you had, like, 20 models, that's when you start saving time. And correct me if I'm wrong, like, I want to sneak this little question in. Do you find it, like, just far more difficult to produce that quality while you're on stream trying to educate people your techniques?
Yes. Less so now, but when I first started streaming, I noticed a lot of my models, while I was getting a lot done, the standard just wasn't the same as if you just sat down and did it not on stream, because you're too busy talking, engaging with people, and talking people through what you're doing, and there's so much else to concentrate on, and then you come off stream, you realize, oh, this isn't as smooth as I would have done it recently, you know, otherwise.
I feel you on that. My major problem is I just can't get into my cradle, like my position, you know, my maximized, you know, I just can't get in my situation. So everything is just like a little bit more uncomfortable, a little bit more difficult for me.
It's why I haven't got the top down. That's why I've got the top down set up. I'm too short for the setup you guys have.
You could probably just get rid of those.
Well, I actually copied your setup. I just last night I stayed up till like 4 a.m. because I was like, I gotta fucking change something up. Because I got all these tripods for all these little tutorials we do, and I snake my arm under one tripod. Like, it's so uncomfortable. And I was like, how can I get this better camera angle? So I actually posted it on Instagram where I took one of my like $11 Walmart desk lamps. It's like a crane arm, like desk lamp. Ripped it to pieces. Manhandled the piece that holds the bulb and that shoots the light out, ripped it off, carved it all up with a drill, pulled the cord off, and I epoxied a tripod wing nut to the place that used to be where the light bulb stand was, and just put my Logitech on it, and now my Logitech has this totally articulating
mechanical
crane arm that I can get I can put in front of me for, like, actual close-up overheads. Because I was just like, I got to change something. I'm watching your stream, watching your stream, seeing like how you are able to get in your cradle and your rhythm a little bit easier than me. And I was like, well, I don't have the problem being short. I have like the obesity problem. Where, like, I'm just like take up too much space on my desk. So I need something to come in hot, you know, from a new angle.
Wow, I just pulled it up on Instagram. You got a video on here.
Yeah, I did a lot of Instagram videos. Like, look at this. I call it the hobo camera crane.
Hobo, hobo camera crane.
Yeah.
I'm going to like it. I liked it.
Well, speaking of techniques and stuff like that, each painter has some kind of gimmick or gadget or special paint that they go to. For me, Kenny turned me on to a paint called Reaper Harvest Brown that I use in my final stages for everything, to dust, to rust, to rain streaks, anything like that. And of course, like, dull oil bails you out of a lot of issues. Do you have any special gadget or something? Yeah, dull oil is liquid talent to me.
I really like Lamenta's Yellow, the yellow glaze from Games Workshop, the Citadel glaze, because it's so good for making. I paint a lot of Sylvaneth and Wood Elves and bright things. All of my color schemes are bright. And with my favorite color is red, so it just boosts up like all those warm colors like yellow, red. You can use it, you can dry brush a Terminator stone or a light dry brush over green, and then glaze it all yellow, and it brings the green up to a really bright green.
But then the
bone dry brush is then yellow, or like a mossy, bright color, and it just brings it all together, and I think it's crazy, and I love it. And I'm also guilty of using a lot of turquoise colors, like Temple Guard blue and Baharoff blue, but I think that's more of a color preference.
Didn't you do a video on yellow for Warhammer TV?
Yeah, no, I think I did Imperial Fist armor for the Advent calendar.
Yep.
That's when I was like brand new and super wooden. So yeah, I was super scared in that video. But yeah, yellow is.
But you crushed it. I remember just like being like, "This is crazy! You paintbrush this yellow like to unbelievable levels." Very easy.
Yeah, it's just as far as I remember, it's just a white. So you spray it all white, and then you just go straight in with a bright Euro yellow, and bone highlight it up. And it's done. Wow. It's obviously you recess shade it so you don't darken down that bright yellow you've obtained. It's the same with like whites and stuff. You don't do an all over shade, as tempting as it is. I had to be like slapped out of that habit.
Bright colors. That's Haspel's go to.
Yeah.
It's so easy to do an all over shade.
I just white all null oil, like pretty much dip it in null oil and then dry brush white over the top.
It's like a null oil sandwich.
Do you guys remember when Devil in Mind first hit? Like, GW is like, we always say GW is the greatest model making company on earth. But we've always said that they might not be the best paint making company on earth.
The technicals are off the chain.
They always come up with something. Like, they always hit you with some new thing in the paint world to remind you, like, hey guys, we are the biggest and the baddest. And even though they might not have invented some of these things, they had the means in which to educate the most amount of people on some of these new techniques. Because I know there was people making washes way before them, but they didn't have the exposure to advertising.
And some other companies doing
Wonder Wash, yep. And then so when they dropped Devil in Mud, I mean, it was a literal. We had inks before that. And I remember like inking everything. Mm. We're like, this is the shit, ink and dry brush. And then when they came out with, you know, fucking wash, I was like, God damn it, you know how many minutes of my life I will never get back?
It's like you learned dry brushing all over again.
It was just like, whoa.
So I want to rewind a second and ask a question purely for selfish reasons. I'll just be upfront about that. So you mentioned Baja Roth Blue. That is actually one of the colors for the official GW how to paint your Thunder Tusks or guys. So, and that's actually an edge paint, which I have never used. I assume it works very same to do a lot of the hyper highlighting and stuff that we do after we do airbrushing. You know, you just go in and you hit the edges. How you mentioned it's one of your go-tos. How do you use it?
I use it on most things. I have an Eldar Force, which have it's a Wraith Force, and they have their helmets are all Baja Roth Blue, and so are their blades and spot colors and everything. I just use it as a normal paint. It's slightly thinner because it's an edge paint for highlights, but mine's quite old, so it's got thicker. you just apply it as normal, and it's perfectly fine.
I guess that was the big question, because they were using the blue consistency, because it's almost like a teal, like you were saying, to get in there and work the to kind of add a little blue palette to the fur. And I was like, well, this is an edge paint, and I've never used those before, so I was hoping it was more of a normal paint than a dry, because those dries are a completely different animal.
Yeah, they shock a lot of people who don't know what the dry paint is. And when I first bought one, no one explained to me what it was. I thought it was broken.
Me too.
I had a guy ask me in stream today as well. Like, I've stirred it. It's not going like paint. What's wrong with it? It's like, it's not really as technical as a dry paint.
Okay.
There's no special way of using it. I don't think so.
So it's more like this. So it sounds kind of like how a lot of people buy the Vallejo airbrush paints, like Vallejo Air.
Slightly watered down.
A lot of like top painters just paintbrush with those paints.
Yeah, I'm using the Citadel Air, especially for the whites, because I find they gum up quite easily in the top. But for freehand, Citadel Air Black is really good for black air freehand, so any script writing. Or they're just good for things like that.
And what a coincidence.
Yeah,
all black already coming out. So there's some secret tech for all the Death Watch bandwagoners that are going to be jumping on.
Motherfucker, I've been playing Death Watch the second edition.
Yeah, seriously. I've been playing
Eldar and Death Watch the second edition.
I'm just a bit salty because I'm an old school Grey Knight player, and when the Grey Knights got good, everybody started playing Grey Knights and ruined my fun. I felt a little bit hurt that I was like, oh, my special army is not special anymore.
I'm not special. And it's our inside joke because, like, when Eldar came out and they're just, you know, obviously continue to be, like, the most just incredible codex and with the best formations and supplements, we always call people for being bandwagoners. And the number one response is, I've been playing Eldar since second edition. Nobody has been playing Eldar since second edition. You just made that up so you don't sound like a bandwagoner.
All right. So here's a tough question for you, and it opened a big debate. How do you pronounce, and I'm going to say it the way we do, Abaddon Black?
I'd say Abaddon Black.
Okay.
It's just... I can't even really get my head around your pronunciation.
what do you mean, us people?
I think it's the accent. I really think Abaddon.
Abaddon. You know what's so funny about that is when I first, because he was the one, probably the first model I ever bought for myself, Chaos for Life. And I was like, Abaddon? I fucking have no idea. Like, I just literally couldn't figure out how to say his name. So thank you for telling us the Queen's English, I guess.
I guess that's the way, but, you know, there's always arguments over paint names anyway.
You know what I need to ask her, too? Okay, the new orcs, the Uruks, with your accent and everything, how do you say it?
Uruk.
So it sounds very similar to orc.
Yeah, really close to orc.
Yeah,
and that was my prediction. I was like, because for us, we in America, we're like Uruks, and I was like, I bet you with the accent, they're just like, it's orcs, dog. Like,
it's the same with the elves. So elves is exactly the same. You know, it's just slightly elves. It's just spelt differently. And it's the same with the ogres. It just makes me sound posher when I say ogre instead of ogre.
I pretty much do everything with my pinky out, so I have no problem pronouncing it like that.
I knew it. It was like almost the same for them. For us, it's a huge problem because we don't know how to.
I can barely talk half the time, I'll be honest.
Me speak pretty one day.
Yes.
Well, guys, do we have any more questions for Em, or we can let her go get back to playing her video game?
Why don't you take this opportunity, Em, to do any promoting, any social media promoting for the people who listen?
Sure. Part of Brush Lickers United. Our stream team on Twitch. You should follow us all, but I'm going to promote my own one because I'm here. I'm Electric Eve on Twitch. I'm currently going to be painting all of my Silver Death. That's what I'm doing at the moment. I may also be painting Death Guard in the future, because that's my 30k army.
Yes.
And I'm planning on doing Bretonians next week, actually, as a celebration for meeting my donation goal for a new desk. I'm going to be painting a pink and yellow Bretonian Pegasus Knight, as requested by one of my mods, but I'll be doing some other crazy stuff next week, because I'm moving house next week. Ooh. But follow me on Twitter. I post a lot of hobby related things and a lot of things relating to my hamster and other things. It's I can't think M, or one word. Instagram as well, which is Electric Eve also. So yeah, it's all model pictures primarily, some other stuff thrown in when I feel
you mean
like
model like toy soldier model.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah, toys.
I mean, there's two different, you know.
There's two different types of Instagram accounts that girls have.
It's all
plastic men.
Okay. We like those.
And occasionally a plastic lady.
Nice.
But yeah. Great.
Well, thank you for putting up with us and taking time out of your schedule to join us here and shed some light on our questions.
It's all right. It's quite late. So I'm going to go to bed, I think.
All righty.
Haspel, you had a shout-out to me.
Yeah, Lamont Lillard, good friend of the show. He was actually in my backyard, like, you know, it at Gamers Haven and everything this last week, and I could not meet up with him because I was stuck at stupid work. So my apologies to Lamont, and I really did want to meet up with him, but it just didn't work out.
Man, when you said backyard, I was like, was he looking for Pokemon?
Was he literally, yeah, what was he? Was he trying to catch them all in your backyard?
No, he was in the Springs, and he went down to check out Gamers Haven and everything. So,
well, that's what's up. We all can't get away. Sometimes it happens.
Yeah.
But. So with this FAQ, we obviously already talked about it, and we've just determined it is obviously the sickest thing ever because Grey Knights didn't really need an FAQ anyway, so that's good they didn't get one.
Yeah. And somebody wrote in the thread, and I'm totally stealing this, and I'm not going to give them credit for it, but they wrote, so you can sum up the Grey Knight FAQ like this, Grey Knight player. So can I GW? No. That's it.
And what pisses me off about that is when I got salty about the Chaos Space Marines, when I went in there and said, like, this is a perfect opportunity to start fixing some of the things in the Codex that are very obvious. You know, like what I brought up, like, everyone knows a Chaos Space Marine needs some kind of special rule and not just fail a leadership check and be out of the game for a turn or get swept. You know, like, you shouldn't have a unit of Astartes equivalent literally, physically, rules-wise, everything, and even cost more than standard Space Marines. You can't have them just, like, roll a 9 this one turn or a 10, and they're out of the game for a turn. Like, they fall back, and then now they can move 3 inches, and that's it. Like, they don't have it. I was like, how can you justify that? And this guy, somebody hit me up, they're like, this is not an errata. This is an FAQ. It's like, they errata something almost every other FAQ. This is quite obviously both errata and FAQ.
Yeah.
And they're just not taking this prime opportunity to give us a couple of little fixes, little point reductions here and there, maybe a couple of sprinkling some love, but no, they're only going to do that with Dreadnoughts, and they're gonna continue to move forward with the whole Dreadnoughts are still armored, they just have more attacks.
Well, you know, for as much junk as we've talked in the past 2 days, there's only 40 comments in here. I mean, I feel like the Dreadnought got way more attention than the Grey Knights are getting here. But let's run it down real quick. So the first point is, can the Grey Knights player use the Aegis special rule to reroll ones made in a Deny the Witch test against psychic powers that did not target any of their units, i.e. Blessings, for example? The answer, of course, is no. Because that would be silly broken.
That was fairly obvious, but I have run into some people that argued that you could, so...
It's at least
definitive that GW just said, no, you can't.
I agree. It was probably necessary. Like Kenny was saying, it's really tough to go completely raw in this day and age because it's more rules as intended at this point, especially when they're printing, there's stuff in print that literally the FAQs contradict these days. So it's really not rules as written. It's really rules as intended.
Is what's clutch about designer notes making it into Death Watch.
Yeah, there's a lot in there, too. Second up, does a Grey Knights unit from the Nemesis Strikes Force riding a drop pod from another detachment get to use the rights of teleportation command benefit to roll for reserves on turn one? Answer is, you can't start the game embarked in allied transport vehicles. Wah, wah.
Yeah, I almost felt like the guy who answered that question wanted to write stupid. He probably actually typed stupid at the end of that sentence and then deleted it.
Yeah, because like, he's got to realize people were asking these questions long before they were started answering these questions.
True.
And so I'll guarantee our boy Austin asked that one because that was his – it was already hard to – because there's literally 5 pages of like deductive reasoning and like sourcing you have to do just to convince somebody that you can do that tactic. Mm-hmm. And so luckily you just can't be in the transport anymore. So the guy didn't have to break it down for 5 pages on why you can't or can. He just said, sorry, bro. Like, we've taken that out of the game.
Yeah.
Somebody in here asked, why can't Grey Knights take storm shields? And I really want to reply, they can. They just come stock with a Drago attached to it.
Yeah, that's right.
Anywho, question, did Grey Knights have access to Space Marine relics? Answer is no. And then somebody in the thread also was like, all right, fess up. Who asked question number 3?
Yeah, I actually knew somebody back in the day that he was doing some crazy stuff with his Grey Knights, and I was like, oh, man, how are you able to pull that off? And he's like, well, I give my chapter master an adamantine mantle, and I'm like, yeah, I'm pretty sure that's not legal.
Pretty sure that my librarians had the Shield Eternal this whole time.
So. Obviously. Question, can Grey Knight unit equipped with personal teleporters use its 30-inch teleport shunt move to leave combat? Answer is no.
Nope. What? You mean units can't just freely move out of close combat anymore?
Apparently not. This is Age of Sigmar.
Sad face.
Switching weapon cycle here. Option selecting over to Astra Militarum first draft. First two questions, all knows. Should Commissar Yerik have the Stubborn special rule? Is the Tarox Prime meant to have the Assault Vehicle special rule? And should the Hydra have Interceptor special rule? All knows. Just no.
You can't even throw us one bone. You know, the Hydra is so fresh if it has the Interceptor rule.
It's like, what's the point of Death from... Like,
it became the thing now. Useless tank when they removed Interceptor. When they changed Skyfire... So that you couldn't also shoot the ground?
It's like its whole point is to like shoot things in the air, and now.
But why wouldn't you turn these super cannons? It's obviously on a turret. Like you would obviously like. I mean, you'd bring them up to the battlefield and be like, aim them at the guys in front of us, guy. I mean, like you know, think about a weapon that can shoot into the sky accurately and hit airplanes. That's mounted on a vehicle like that. I mean, dog, come on, just aim it downfield too.
Yep, maybe the machine spirit does not like to drop to 180. I don't know.
And they made it more points, so it's like they couldn't throw us a bone. Yeah, so.
Especially when you have to take one as part of the steel host, I feel like we need two bones now. Anyways, question: when fire on my target order is issued, do both units, the officer and the ordered unit, need line of sight to the target, or just the ordered unit? And the answer is only the ordered unit needs line of sight.
Which is actually yes, so that's cool. That's cool, you know.
Color Sergeant Krells, listen up, Maggot special rule. How does this interact with abilities that force a unit to use its lower leadership? This one's kind of irrelevant. It only affects the unit taking a leadership test for orders issued by Creed. As the result of enemy ability, a unit forced to use its lower leadership when taking a leadership test for an order from Creed, they can still use Krells' ability as long as the same unit is Creed.
Creed. Sure.
All is planned, I guess. Question, can you add Ministorum Priest, Primaris Psykers, and Engine Seers to formation? Because remember, they don't take up a slot, technically. The answer is no. Which I agree with. I kind of agree with it.
Yeah, sorry. I mean, it's
you can't sneak stuff into formations like that.
No.
It will throw off the balance. This one was interesting. What is the firing arc of the Chimera's las gun arrays?
Remember, it is controversial.
Those three little things that on each side of the tank, they can rotate 180, are each one on each side is an
physically
array.
Physically rotate. Like when you build this model, it is designed in the instructions to glue it in such a way that they move around literally 180 degrees in all directions. Physically.
Okay. Apparently, the answer is they're whole mounted weapons and they have a 45 degree arc. But don't ask us which direction.
So now there are a lot more like... the ghost arc where like the broadsiding is fixed.
But you can't split fire.
But you know that going in as a Necron player, you know, they're fixed in the model design. Here they made us but this is also an old kit that's been around since the dawn of time. And they never had an array rule. What they had was five people can shoot out of the vehicle. They trimmed it to two people can shoot out of the vehicle and you have the array. And so that's obviously an old kit design. So now what they're saying is it's just 45 degrees. You can only shoot one side at a time, basically, because you're never going to be able to get both on the same target.
I don't know. It's something that needs another FAQ, I feel like, because you could literally rotate those things around.
It's silly.
It is definitely silly. More highlights, because there is three whole pages, and I'm sure we don't want to get bored with all of that. Can you clear up ordnance in heavy vehicles? Lehman Russ owners have been wondering about this for some time. The answer is, heavy has no effect on firing ordnance weapons. If a heavy vehicle doesn't fire an ordnance weapon, it can fire up all of its weapons at full ballistic skill when moving at combat speed.
And that seems confusing, but there was like a weird catch in the way it was worded, where rules is written, it kind of indicates that you can't shoot the heavy weapons. Because if you move, because of the way it was poorly worded on the Lehman Russ's entry.
Yeah, ordnance has always been.
And in the USR entry. So It's cool they cleared that up. They're like, no, it's an either or thing. You're good to go, bro.
So that was the majority of the stuff from the Astra Militarum, I feel like. Not overall, some good stuff and some bad stuff once again. I guess it's about 50-50 on the good versus bad there. What are you guys feeling on it?
The Astra Militarum, I'm lukewarm to. I don't play them, so it's okay. The Grey Knight one, it's a waste of paper.
Well, That yeah.
Virtual
to your point.
Yeah, a waste of valuable minutes of my life.
So, yeah,
but, you know, maybe Matt Ward can do something.
We still don't know what capacity he's working there, so that's really interesting.
I'm hoping he's like a Professor X capacity.
He's the only one who cares about Grey Knights.
He's your Lord and Savior.
He is.
He will lead you out of the darkness. So I put out this morning a top 10 things you need to know about Death Watch, or surprises in the Death Watch book, and I feel like, all caveats aside, I'm going to write a follow-up article maybe tomorrow, depending on how late I'm up or slash drunk tonight, about the thing I missed. And I was very critical on my own article because I actually forgot something that I feel like might be one of the very top things that I should have included in the article, unfortunately. But I didn't, because reasons. However, we're going to talk about that first off in Death Watch, or Death Watch preview of the new book here. So that was supposed to be my intro where I had enough time to pull up the article, but that didn't work so well. So here we go. You like that?
Yeah.
That was an awesome segue. Anyways, so we're going to skip right to the relics, which honestly, this is the only relic I feel very strongly about. Tell me what you're thinking about this. It's 30-point relic. The only real caveat that I can see to using it is that you have the demand has to be in the cut or in the trenches to switch the spots, and that is the Dominus, the Beacon Aegeus Angelus, EIEIO. Friendly units do not scatter when they deep strike, so long as the first model is placed within 6 inches of a model bearing the Beacon Angelus. In addition, once per game at the start of any friendly movement phase, the bearer can use the beacon to teleport his comrades to his position. Okay, so not only is it basically a homer, he can also use it to
teleport. It's a lot like that old, there was a Grey Knight psychic power that was kind of like that. Yes. Back in the day, where you could like flip around with rhinos and razorbacks and
pull them toward you.
Oh no, you go
yeah. move them.
Psychic beacon, I think, was like the upgrade yes. you take on the vehicles. Remember that? And you can deep strike to it. So it's like they're going back to that. And it's also like electro displacement. So obviously GW is all about these new exciting ways to move armies that have a lot of guys that walk around in weird ways. Cause like that's like the game is a lot more boots to the ground than vehicles to the ground than it did in fifth, you know, except for the exception of obviously Gladius Strike Force. But that's interesting to see these new ways to move your models around.
Yeah, no, I agree. So you can basically take a unit off the board and then place it deep strike right next to the guy with the beacon, and it doesn't deep strike scatter or mishap or anything like that as long as you can place it. So, I mean, theoretically, you can load up a Land Raider, dump some dudes out right next to you, boom.
Yeah.
Wow. Among other things. That was the big one that I felt like I actually did everyone a disservice and forgot to mention, but it is what it is there. So running down the list, number one is the frag cannon. We talked about that on the webcast, but that thing is the normal frag cannon profile, but if you're within 12, its solid shot profile goes from, I think it's strength 7, AP 4 at 24, it goes to strength 9, AP 2 at 12 inches.
Assault 2?
Yeah, so it's like straight up double shot las cannon at 12 inches.
Wow.
At over 24 inches, right?
No, the shot... If you're at 24, the shot is strength 7, AP 4, I believe.
So it's like it loses power as it goes.
Yeah. Technically,
And it's only 25 points, like we talked about. It's literally the points of a Last Cannon Devastator Squad right now, and it is essentially, if deployed correctly, a two-shot Last Cannon. And if at range, still strength 7 shot, is it still assault 2 at range?
Yes.
So it's at worst for 25 points, it's, you know, a unit of
an auto cannon.
These veterans that can have it, like, they have four of them. That's like a Devastator squad. So at worst, it's like having four autocannons. At best, it's like having eight las cannons. And then additionally, in the cut, it's like having it is literally like 10 strength 6 rending flamers. Like, it is crazy good for 25.
Yeah, you know what it reminds me of? And I'm going to curse myself right now saying this. It went back in the day in 5th edition with the purifier spam, when you'd run 10 purifiers with 4 psi cannons and psi bolt ammo, that's what this unit is sounding like.
Yeah,
it does.
You have like four of these frag launchers, and then because they're Death Watch, they can use any of the special bolt ammo they have.
Yep.
And reach out and touch it. They could probably put out a lot of firepower.
It is deadly and affordable, and it is versatile. It's three modes of fire that is like practically unprecedented, I think. Like,
well, remember too that like the rest of the squad, or you're gonna have one of those mission tactics, so you're gonna be plus one to hit.
Preferred enemy, force organization.
Yeah, the foe preferred enemy, or excuse me, the reroll hits a one on both combat. Well,
is
I guess
it reroll, is it reroll hits or is it preferred enemy?
So it's just to hit. So technically, it works for combat too, but it wouldn't matter for this.
I mean, it's brutal. Like it not only does it have three modes of fire, it's three aggressive modes of fire.
And then couple that with the sudden onslaught roll, which is the command benefit of their Decurion, that gives every non-vehicle unit deep strike. So I feel like you're going to be within 12.
I think it's so powerful. We've talked about it on the webcast. It's so powerful. If you just want a deep strike in, you could put them in the new flyer, and also with the new Decurion, like you can your minimum obligation is one of five of these guys and a one Terminator to make this Decurion, and so now you're talking about like this unit can be like a billion models of all different unit types, or it can be a very efficient, unit of five dudes with four of these new guns plus one dude in Terminator armor with a storm shield, literally just to mean that you have to wound me seven times before I take my first three up armor save. Like, just to be a blade of, and then if you have one guy in the squad who doesn't have the special weapon, that means Terminator on point seven, you have to wound me seven times before I take my first three up save. Additional two more for that guy to die before my first guy with a special gun dies. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So like you're talking 10 actual wounds before the first armor save is taken on one of these guys with special weapons. And when you do normal math, like when you talk about like Gladius Strike Force, where they have these minimum squads with grab guns and commie grabs in them, you have to do 15 wounds to pick up that unit of Space Marines. This unit is 10 wounds before the first armor save is rolled on a guy who has a good gun.
Yeah.
It's incredible. And a heavy grav cannon at 35 points, a combi grav at 15 points. So that's literally a gun that if it moves only has three shots. If it stands still, it has five shots for 35 points. This is a gun that's a two-shot las. These are guns that are two-shot las cannons or auto cannons or the super frag launcher for 25 points. And plus, they don't have a 10-point one-shot only gun. Like it stacks up. It's incredible. I've never even heard of a unit like this. This is fully mind blowing.
Yeah.
Oh, I agree. Like I'm stoked. Like everything I hear about this codex, or everything I read about this codex, I just get more and more excited. Number three is Atonement Through Honor, which is it lets some models get double attacks when versus monsters, creatures, independent characters, vehicles, and more. Like when they're outnumbered, kind of like Rampage on Crack. Number four is the transport, the Corvus Black Star, can be equipped to reroll failed saving throws from Jinky, and I think it's only 5 or 10 points to do that, which
always worth, unless it's like a billion points. I mean, if it's 20 or less points, always worth the upgrade.
Yeah, oh, I just can't see the disadvantage to doing it.
And that'll let you deliver, when you come in loaded up, instead of getting shot out of the sky and having to take strength 10 hits on everybody, it'll let you deliver it.
I'm actually going to skip number five because I want to come back and kind of end on that and get you guys' thoughts because I know you've been thinking about it. Number six is Artemis is not in a codex. He's only in a Deathmatch box set.
Oh, really?
Yep. There's a little 40-page supplement in there that has a really good story about what's going on in that Crystal Moon and, the Death Watch and the Harlequins parlaying didn't go well for the Harlequins. And so it's an interesting little... There's specific little formation data sheets in there. Same with Eldar as well. So it's worth picking up, or if somebody picks it up and you just want the rules, you'd be like, yo, dog, can I get your rule pack? Good stuff in there still. Up to four Death Watch veterans can take the new frag cannon in a squad. We talked on that. It's powerful. And it's not just that. They can take any of the anything from the heavy list. Bikes can be taken model by model and maybe upgraded with a power weapon for 5 points. Something else about bikes is that they have skilled rider, which does convert to the squad. So if you have one of those formations that makes a kill team, now you're conferring skilled rider to it, which is pretty dope. Just a little caveat there. It's just something you're going to see, stuff's going to start stacking up. Number 9, Terminators are fearless and can have the Melta Fist for 10 points. That can be, it's not just a one use, and any Terminator can have any loadout from Thunderhammer Storm Shield to Lightning Claws to Assault Cannon to Cyclone Launcher.
Yeah,
they can be purchased model by model.
That's really powerful. I mean, it could get very expensive really, really quickly.
Sure.
But you can do the combo, you know, have guys with Thunderhammer Storm Shields up front. Everybody has a Cyclone Missile Launcher.
It's a lot like those armies that a lot of people used to play where, you know, you take the old Space Wolf, you take the Wolf Guard, and you have any of them can be Terminators, and people would take like 20-man squads of these guys walking around a table all mixed up. Like, it's very similar to that, the last edition Space Wolf Codex, and the fact that it's like literally whatever you want, it has.
Yeah.
And people played it. I mean, there's some people who are winning tournaments with that style list.
I'm excited for that because I have a bunch of, shooty Terminators that haven't seen the tabletop in a long time. So that I'm feeling like they're about to get repainted.
Congratulations. You have been inducted into the Death Watch.
Yeah.
Make the sign of the Aquila. Number 10, Vanguard Vets can also be taken model by model, and the heroic intervention rule applies to any unit with a Vanguard Vet in it as well. So formations, you're going to start stacking up more special rules.
Just add like a token Vanguard Vet.
What is a heroic intervention these days? Is it just scattered D6, or what is it?
Reroll charge range or something like that?
Ignore penalties for disordered charges and can reroll one or both dice when determining its charge range.
So, yes, obviously take one, make the squad better.
Yeah, and multi-charge.
And it's also an easy way to get that heavy Thunderhammer, too, if you want it. So, back up to number 5. Several formations feature super units. See the kill team special rule consisting of Terminators, Bikes, Jump, and regular infantry, all of which, because generally all of them cannot be larger than 10 models, including transport, so they can obviously fit in Dark Star and can benefit from multiple special rules. You know, we talked about a couple already. Remember, the Assault Pack can reroll the charge distance per the GW FAQ as well. Now you got Heroic Intervention that can stack, Skilled Rider that can stack. If you throw a Sanguinary Priest in there, feel no pain.
Skilled Rider, I love, you know, having units that have Jinxes. I had one guy with Skilled Rider. That's so fresh. Obviously, yeah, but you know, if you're going to take the super unit, it turns out Blood Angels are back to the ultimate ally again.
Yep.
Yeah, definitely.
Somewhere Mephiston is cringing, like, or not Mephiston, Dante is like so angry. It's like, we gave him the Storm Raven and now I got a drop ship. Oh, so angry.
I mean you're talking easily, you could take the mega unit, you take the Sanguinary Priest again. You take the mega unit, you take one ally, Blood Angels, Priest, 5 scouts, then you take a follow up ally, Sisters of Battle, say Celestine, with the priest that has the auto-pass War Hymns.
Mm-hmm.
So Saint Celestine, auto-pass priests, 5 sisters tucked in reserves with those scouts, and now you have this mega unit that has literally reroll all armor saves in close combat, hit and run, feel no pain, and if you were playing a tournament that had unlimited sources, you know, you could figure out a way to sneak scout into that unit with obviously, you know, Grey Knight or Inquisitors with the... Liber Heresius or whatever. But like, you know, you can obviously, you know, but that's if you put a lot of stock into the War Priest. You can obviously just go and take, you know, Samael, give you hit and run and scout, you know, if you wanted to just say, I don't need to reroll armor saves in close combat.
Yeah. Wow.
I mean, there's definitely options, and and the core of all of these super squads are always 5 veterans, it looks like, for the most part. And remember, 4 of those veterans can have your frag cannon. So these guys isn't going to be a chump squad. You know what I mean?
How many units of veterans could be in the Decurion? Just one, or could it be a maximum of some other number?
Oh, well, so the Decurion is different from the little formations at the back. You can have multiples of the little formations that form those, like, super little kill team things. As far as... the Decurion goes, you only need one core, one auxiliary, and one command.
What's the max? Is there like a 1 to something, or is it always just 1?
Everything's 1 plus. The command is 1 to 3, but for the command, there's only one unit, which is... But
my question is, how many of these veteran squads can is the max?
You mean the 5-man veteran squad with frag cannon, or are you talking about the formations?
Yes. Within the Decurion, of my obligatory requirement to take in this core units, what I have a requirement of 1. Is there a maximum of 3?
No. For kill team, there's one unit of veterans, and it is core 1+. So you can pretty much have as many veterans as you can fit in the points.
So before this super squad of all the guys together we're talking about.
So those are also core for the most part. It looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Those are all core. Yep, those are all core, so they are also 1+.
So you basically make a super squad with like 3 veteran squads in it with 12 frag cannons.
You couldn't do that.
Okay.
Each formation is a self-contained maximum of 10 super squad. And you can have unlimited of those for your points in this Black
Spear. Oh, okay. So I can have 5 veterans and a Terminator, 5 veterans and a Terminator, 5 veterans and a Terminator like over and over again?
Yes.
But if you played ITC, I think they cap you at spamming identical formations.
Well, there's 5 different ones. So
is there 5 different ones that all require you to take, that all let you take veterans?
Yeah, so 1, 2, they're all based, the very first choice is always a veteran in each kill team. Then there's 1, 2, 3 that equip you with Terminators. Some of them, Terminators are optional, but they force you to take a bike, or they force you to take a librarian, or they force you to take
things, every single one of these things that go in the new flyer.
Correct, because it's a maximum of 10.
Yeah, so that's, literally, man, I mean, it's, you can make some really fun armies with this stuff.
And then also, too, remember, they're going to get, because if they're part of the Black Spear Strike Force, they automatically all have deep strikes, so they technically don't even need the flyer if you don't want to.
Yeah, well.
True, but the flyer is probably my go-to, because flyers are strong. They're going to continue to get stronger. This flyer is a Storm Raven, but better in my opinion, because it's even though it has less armor, it has the rerollable jinx save, has similar firepower, but also has the ability to deliver these units very effectively. I mean, out the gate, I love like spamming an idea, a concept. I love the idea of like 3 of these flyers, one ready for takeoff on a sky shield, all of them filled up with these cool squads and something else in my army. I love the Sky Shield. That's what Juice had recommended, because I love it, because if you're chilling on a table to start the game with and somebody sees initiative on you, you are like, okay, I have rerollable jinx saves on the Sky Shield, especially if you can, which is good, obviously. But then if they, like I say, they can recover, you still have 4 invulnerable on the Sky Shield.
Yeah.
You know, so like that, I think that's fun. And if they, obviously they win the roll to go first, you don't even have to use Ready for Takeoff on your Sky Shield. I think that there's some interesting options. This flyer is fun. Deep striking these units in is really fun. Especially with all these new relics and everything, I think there's gonna be a lot of plays with this new codex. I think this codex has the power to kill some units and relatively inexpensive point investments for how powerful these units are.
Yeah, I 100% agree with that too. And then there's even some super formations which lets you take multiples of, one of each of the kill team, or some up to 4, and they confer even more special rules too. So there's lots of different options for fielding these kill teams, or these super little mini squads. So we're definitely going to see them, I feel like. There's no doubts in my mind there.
Endless bikes and flyers if you want it. I love it. It's so strong.
Yeah, endless bikes on planes.
Megaforce. I'm going to coin that term right now.
There it is.
Yep.
You heard it here first. We're like trendsetters. Man. Well, I think we hit all of our points, and we got that great interview in as well. So I'm sure Juice will be back with us next week as well. He had some stuff come up last second. He's back at the slinging the food and the truck this week. School's back in business, so handling some things there. So Haspel, why don't you take us out, bud?
All right. I am a ranger We walk in the dark places no one will enter. We stand on the bridge and no one may pass. We live for the one, we die for the one. Until Zaveni, in Valen's name.
If you like these battle reports, check out thelongwar.net. Become a member of the Hall of Veterans today for the fastest growing library of wargame related video content, modeling, painting, and playing. Not to mention all the sick discounts I receive from some of our sponsors. TheLongWord.net is committed to bringing hobby back. We can't do it without you.